Surf, sun, and sand, great food, a Ferris wheel, rides, games, a music stage, classic cars, and fun, fun, fun. That's what's in store for you at the Musquamicut Spring Festival, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, May 13th, 14th, and 15th at Musquamicut State Beach. On the shores of Westerly, Rhode Island, the Musquamicut Spring Festival is a great way to start the 2022 beach season. For more information, log on to MusquamicutFestival.org. Musquamicut Spring Fest.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Musquamicut Beach Show. My name is Ben Barber, and today I am very excited because we are talking to this year's headliner, one of the headliners for Springfest. I'm so excited. Kyle Vincent, he was called the Crown Prince of Soft Pop by Goldmine. Barry Manilow said one of the best singer-songwriters to come along since the heyday of Tin Pan Alley. He will be here on Saturday night. Ladies and gentlemen, the one and only Kyle Vincent. Kyle, how are you? Can you hear
how
me, Kyle?
How are you? Hello.
Hello. Thank you so much for coming to Musquamicut Beach. We're so excited to get to see you.
Yeah, I can't say it, but I'll be there. Wait, my
that's
jacket.
That's okay.
Let's take off the jacket. There we go. It's an outdoor show. Let's be outdoors. Look, the striptease has already started.
Absolutely.
There's more of that coming on Saturday the 14th.
So we're really excited about this. Obviously, you know, most of us, we love your music. Tell us a little bit about what you'll be playing on Saturday.
Well, I'm going to be solo, which is going to be quite an endeavor. Hopefully people will stick with me there for 2 hours, but I'm going to go through my personal catalog and then some songs. I've been in a few different bands. I've been in Bo Donaldson, the Haywoods. I've been in the Bay City Rollers, or what was left of them. And I've toured with some pretty famous people and recorded all sorts of different songs. So it'll be all over the place. And, you know, some intimate stuff. And some fun summery things, because we got to celebrate the warm weather. Yay.
Absolutely. And that's what we love, right? We love the intimate stuff, and we love and we love the summertime jams. So tell me about your time in the Bay City Rollers.
Well, I got a call one day. I was walking along Hollywood Boulevard. It's, you know, that's the way these things happen. You're just walking along Hollywood Boulevard. And
not me, but you, yes.
As you
sure.
know.
Yes.
Well, some people it happens to. And I'm walking along and the phone rings and, hey, we need a new singer. Would you like to? And I mean, I loved that band so much when I was a kid, you know?
Yeah.
And in fact, I'll try to make this story real quick, but I played jazz saxophone actually growing up. That was my first instrument. And I guess it was high school, I think it was in 10th grade, 9th grade, a band was having a concert one night in Berkeley, where I grew up in California. And it was at this theater that had a small theater and a big theater. And we were in the small theater. And in the big, and you could hear through the walls, this crazy screaming. So I snuck out of my concert in between sets, and all of a sudden I'm side stage. This is an absolute true story. With the Bay City Rollers. They're on stage and I'm right there on the side looking at them like, oh my God. And that changed a lot of things for me. So, to you know, I thought, I don't know how much more jazz I can play. You know, I want to pop, you know. So so to be asked to join them, you know, so many years later was kind of cool. Yeah, it's really fun.
That's awesome.
So we'll do a few of those songs for sure.
That's fantastic. I love that story. So you are a multi-instrumentalist. How many instruments do you play?
Oh, just multiples of instruments. Mostly on stage, I play piano, keyboard, and guitar. In the studio, I play a few other things. I mean, I still play saxophone. I picked up the flute during this awful pandemic. I learned video editing and the flute. So I tried to make the best of my time, and Japanese and a little French. So anyway, I play, I don't know. When it's in the studio, I play pretty much anything that's laying about. I just kind of jump on it. I don't play drums, although I haven't ruled it out yet.
And you never should. You never should rule it out. Not that you never should
as
play.
Shan't you?
No. Yes. So.
Oh, okay, great. So, I'm glad you clarified that. Please never play drums. Whatever you do, don't play drums.
Never. No. Kyle, take it from me. Never play drums. Never play drums.
Okay.
So.
Well, remember that you told me that.
You said you were learning Japanese.
Switching
tell
arms.
Me a little... You said you were learning Japanese. You are quite popular in Japan. So I've been told. Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I was in this band many, many moon ago called Candy, back in the some decade gone by. Candy was most famous because we spawned the guitar player Gilby Clark, who ended up in Guns N' Roses. So that's kind of our claim to fame, I guess. But Candy, yeah, we did fairly okay in the U.S. We were kind of forgotten by the record company, so you had to really search to find the record, but I was amazed how many people did that. But in Japan, we were something, you know? We kind of took off there, and it turns out, which I just found out not too long ago, they had used one of our songs for this afternoon kids program. So the school kids coming home after school were hearing, you know, My Silly Voice every day, and they seem to remember it. So sadly, we never toured there. So when I ended up going there in like 2006, there's all these now elderly girls, not elderly, but like in their 40s or so, holding up their Candy records and still, it was quite cute. So that started the following, that connection to that band. And then I've toured there so many times that I've kind of built a new following based on my own music, which is kind of neat.
That's really neat. Yeah. What's it like going over there? When I assume that, you know, things maybe have gotten a little tough the last couple of years, but what's it like getting over there and that whole experience of being so popular in such a foreign country?
Well, yeah, I have not toured pretty much anywhere for 2 years. It's been pretty awful, which is why I can't wait to do this gig, because I'm just going to like explode on stage, maybe literally, who knows. anything could happen. It's been a couple years since I've been there, and Japan feels like a second home for sure to me. It's like New England and Japan. Those, I just seem to go back and forth. I'm very comfortable over there. They have great food, great people. The audiences are wonderful. So I miss it like crazy. They're still closed. They're one of the countries that's really holding out. But hopefully soon they'll open up. Yeah.
Well, I hope so. And when you go back, you'll know a bit more Japanese, which is fantastic.
That's right. Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about your relationship with Barry Manilow. We had the quote, him saying that you were, you know, the greatest songwriter, singer-songwriter.
Since sliced bread?
Yeah, since sliced bread. That's high praise from Barry Manilow. Tell us a little bit about that relationship.
Yeah. Well, if we had a long time, I could tell you the full story of how it started, because it's actually really cool. Well, long story short,
I was playing a gig.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, I don't know if my arm can hold out. I should have put this on a tripod. I was one of the many times I decided I was calling it quits. I'm like, that's it. And I was pretty young, and I was like, no, that's it. My band is over. Nothing's going to happen for me. I'm done. So I thought I'd blow it all out and play one last gig at the Roxy in LA, which is a pretty posh venue, you know? So I'm like, that's it. It was crowded, all that stuff. So at soundcheck, I went into the ticket office and I called the management company that handles Barry Manilow. They're just down Sunset, like this is in LA, maybe, 15 minutes from the Roxy or something. And I called. And it was after hours. And Barry's manager answers the phone. And I go, hello, hello, mister. I'm playing the Roxy tonight, and I'm kind of like a young Barry Manilow in a way, sort of. Maybe you, well, I'm going to put your name on the list. Whatever. You know, just one of those crazy shots in the dark. Well, here's a lesson. There's a lesson to be learned in doing things like this and never giving up, because he showed up, not Barry, his manager. And the whole management team showed up. And the next day I was signed to them. So all of a sudden I'm sitting in their office talking about my career, and, you know, Manilow walks by like, wait, was that? The guy looked just like, and that started a friendship. And and then they, you know, they decided one way to get me out there is put me on tour with him, which was not easy, because my record label signed to a big record label, and they threw a fit when they found out I was going to tour with Barry. You're not back. That'll ruin your career. Don't do it. Don't do it. And I said, well, I'm going. Didn't help me with the record label. Helped me great with fans. I kept those fans that I made on that tour, and I would do it again. Yeah, that's, it was amazing. A wonderful, wonderful gig. Yeah. So we've kind of remained friends over the years. Occasional emails and critiques.
So, I love it.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah. You recently wrote a song for you know, in tribute to Gilbert O'Sullivan, which is a big, I don't know if Gilbert played here or we just had him on the show, but obviously you know, a lot of people here are big fans of him. What inspired that?
Okay. Well, the song is, it's called A Gilbert O'Sullivan Song. It's on YouTube. You can check it out. It's a very cool video, actually. A Japanese artist drew all the pictures. And it's an homage to Gilbert, because his music has meant so much to me. Well, there we go. That's like magic. But it's really disguised as an homage. It's really the story of a 12-year-old boy struggling to, you know, face the I don't fit ins, you know. You can see right there. Look, he's looking out the window. That's a kid who doesn't fit in. I mean, that she captured me to a T, absolutely perfectly.
The art is beautiful. The music is beautiful. I listened to this song earlier, and I absolutely loved it.
I really appreciate that. Thank you. And the biggest praise, well, yours is the biggest, of course, praise, but I did get it over to Gilbert's people, and it got to him, and I got a personal email from him, and the words were incredible. It wasn't just, you know, thank you for writing and singing a song about me. He said people have done that before, but not so professional. And he was really critiquing the structure and the performance and the quality of the songwriting, which, of course, you know, it's a tricky thing to do, to write a song like that. And yeah. You write a little bit of a thin line there. And I wanted to make sure it was about the boy, but the importance of this other artist's music to that, not just a boy, but to me as an adult. You know, I'm just a huge fan of Gilbert's, and he's one of my, like, two or three favorite all-time artists. And frankly, I thought everybody in the U.S. had forgotten about him, and that he was my own secret little, you know, artist. Well, turns out there's thousands and thousands and thousands of us who thought the same thing, and all his shows are sold out. So yeah. I went and saw him in Boston, and we became friends. I'm friends with the family. I flew over to England and bought myself a front row seat and just goo goo gaga. And it was just, and I, every time I see him perform, it's just tears down the eyes every time. I can't fight it, you know, because absolutely, the songs just hit so strong. When music connects to you that much, you got to do something about it. And my outlet is songwriting. So that's what I do.
I love it. I completely agree. When music connects with you that much, you got to do something about it. And we are all grateful that your outlet is songwriting, Kyle, because you are, I mean, I can't give you any higher praise than Barry Manilow, so I won't even try, but you are fantastic.
Sure,
and we're so happy that you're going to be joining us next Saturday, May 14th. So thank you, and I cannot wait to see you. Anything else that you'd like to say before we go?
I can't wait to play Miss Quamacut. Did I get it?
You got it. You got it right.
Yay. I really can't wait. It's going to be fun. You know, come for the music, stay for the mistakes. And the more cotton candy you eat, the better I sound. That's pretty much it. And I'll stick around, say hi to anybody. I'm very approachable. If you want to come and say hi, get things autographed, or just, you know, tell me I'm the worst or the best, feel free. I'd love to meet people.
I love it. I can't wait. I'll be there on Saturday. I can't wait to listen and to see you and to meet you in person. So
great. Please don't throw tomatoes. That's all I ask.
I will not throw any tomatoes. If there are tomatoes, I will eat them.
Okay.
All right. All right. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. Have a good one. Nice to meet you.
Bye. Same here.
All right, guys, check out Kyle, 2 o'clock on Saturday, May 14th. Check out the entire lineup at MissQuamacutFestival.org. You can buy all of your tickets there, get all of your information there. Thank you so much, guys. Bye for now.
Surf, sun, and sand, great food, a Ferris wheel, rides, games, a music stage, classic cars, and fun, fun, fun. That's what's in store for you at the Musquamicut Spring Festival, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, May 13th, 14th, and 15th at Musquamicut State Beach. On the shores of Westerly, Rhode Island, the Musquamicut Spring Festival is a great way to start the 2022 beach season. For more information, log on to MusquamacutFestival.org. Musquamicut Spring Fest.